Hello everyone, you are on the 100x zoom channel. Today we have this star telescope for repair. I don't want to put it back together myself. I need to repair it. The star telescope from the company, someone might read it as Hawke Optics.
Hawke, 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 Hawke.
In fact, it reads as Hawke Optics, Hawke Endurance. It has glass 85 millimeters objective lens diameter. It is somewhat dirty on the outside, but it's not critical. It can be wiped clean. From the inside, it seems clean. There is also another lens here. I won't be doing any major experiments because I'm not up for it right now. I just need to repair it as quickly as possible. I already had such a star telescope, a Japanese one, quite old. There was also an additional lens there, and it added another 3 centimeters to the focal length. I think this one also adds some focal length. This telescope came to me assembled. I disassembled it a bit, helped myself a little here to unscrew some parts. What's the problem? The problem is that in addition to the telescope, the owner added this prism to it. This prism is located approximately here. The telescope fell, the prism flew out of its place and started moving around inside, flying. I think the owner did the right thing. If he hadn't done this, it could have caused even more damage during transportation. So how is it already damaged? It's not fatal. Everything will be fine with it. The image will be normal, I believe. It could also have damaged the prisms that are still here. The price for such a telescope is quite high, approximately $600-$700. The manufacturer claims that the tube was filled with nitrogen. This may be true, as on this side, where the eyepiece screws in, there is glass that does not protect, but prevents air with moisture from entering, and also does not allow nitrogen to escape. It was very well screwed in. There is also a seal inside. So, it is possible that this tube was indeed filled with nitrogen. The weight of such a tube is 1800 grams. The eyepiece magnifies from 25 to 75 times.
The field of view will be set to 25 at a distance of 42 meters. With a magnification of 75 times, the field of view is 21 meters. I am not sure that other sites show different figures. It seems to me that at such a magnification, 21 meters will not be. I think it will be less. Well, for now, I cannot verify this. And in general, it is probably quite difficult to check the exact footage to the meter. But the difference between 10 and 20 meters can probably be understood. Honestly, it's a bit strange to me why such a prism was secured so poorly. Because the tube is relatively expensive, they could have somehow glued some metal or plastic from this side, and then glued some sealant or cement to it, but so that it wouldn't come off. In short, I am setting this part of the tube aside. I don't need it right now. I need to get to these prisms. In order to do this, first you need to cut the seam here. Pry off the silicone here, get to the screws, and unscrew them. Next, I need to separate this black part from this green one. So far, I am not able to do it. I think this focusing wheel is in my way. I need to remove them first. To remove them, you need to unscrew all the small screws that you can see. First, this small focusing wheel is removed, or not. Just this focusing wheel. Later, when I finish the repairs, I will put everything together and show you how they work. Next, I need to try to remove this wheel. And after that, I think it will be possible to disconnect. What do I want to tell you? There is nothing to unscrew here. We need to unscrew from this side. We are removing this part. Just unscrew it. It is on silicone. Set it aside. Next, these screws are already unscrewed, and there are two more here. One is located here. The other is located right here.
After that, we apply a little force. Moreover, after a little, we apply force. It is on silicone and disconnects. And now we have access to both these prisms that are here, and to mount the prism at a 45 degree angle. I have removed one prism. I can correct myself again. Still, to get this prism out, you need to unscrew something here. And just like that, look at how it is done here. You see, there are balls here. And in a word, I understand that in order to... Oops, one fell out. In order for this rod to come out, all these balls need to be removed. In short, I've said so much. What needs to be disassembled and what doesn't. In a word, if your prism that reflects rays at a 45 degree angle has fallen out, then essentially this whole focusing mechanism here should not be touched. If you have any problems with this focusing wheel, then look at how many small parts are here. Honestly, I've even forgotten where everything goes. There are many various counter screws, balls, and so on. Now I will be reassembling all of this. I hope everything will work out for me. Well, if anything happens, you will know what to unscrew, in what order. And so, look, I have already cleaned and assembled the prisms here. This is the prism that was somewhat chipped. In the places where there were chips, I painted them with black paint to avoid glare. And here, on the nose, I will show you, I have this kind of glue. It is extremely strong. I carefully applied it with a brush from all sides, and also here, where the mounting is, between the mountings. First I applied this glue inside, and then I pushed the prism in there. It's very, well, it just seems strange to me because this prism is additionally secured with such a bracket. Why couldn't a better mounting or better glue be thought of here? Well, the tube is quite expensive, and one fall seems to leave everything intact, but the prism pops out. I hope this glue will hold at least somewhat, but I also can't guarantee that the prism won't pop out from a strong fall. Slowly, the repair is coming to an end. Here it is already installed. This cover is greased from the inside, in case a piece of something, possibly silicone or some dust, gets in. It will stick to the walls and not reach the optics. Now only this part needs to be screwed in. The glass here was somewhat dirty. I barely managed to get it out, cleaned it, and glued it. I used a resin that hardens from ultraviolet light. This glass serves to prevent moisture from getting inside, and also to keep the nitrogen from escaping outside. Essentially, this glass plays no role now. It could have been thrown away. But still, it's better to keep it, especially since it is coated. If there were no coating, it could be thrown away because it provides a less bright image. But let it be. This is how it screws in. And if the owner of this tube unscrews the eyepiece, no dirt or dust will get inside. I have finished with the body of the upper tube. I will show the eyepiece. I won't fully disassemble it because, essentially, it's not necessary, as this lens inside is clean. However, a few lenses are dirty. Another lens that is inside, you see, has some blackening. It is inserted and screwed in with a retaining ring. It needs to be cleaned again, as it is not very clean. And then, another lens is simply screwed on top. Here is the locking ring. The other side also needs to be unscrewed and cleaned. The image will be much better because there are some spots on these two. The other lenses here are relatively clean. I don't think there's a need to get into them. Well, that's it. The repair is complete. Some parts were difficult, especially disassembling and assembling this mechanism, and essentially, it could have been left alone. Overall, you saw how it unscrews. The coating is multi-layered, as you can notice, from the inside and outside. The prisms are also coated. Even this protective glass has a coating as well. I will be filming now. And to be honest, I really like this tube, especially its precise focusing when you take it. Choose a magnification of up to 75, as it would be somewhat difficult to adjust the clarity with just this one focusing, so this second wheel helps a lot. Well then, let's watch
Of course, you can also watch the video where I compared the SV Boney SV17 and SV28 telescopes, and you will understand why there is such a price difference. At 25x magnification, I have nothing to complain about. You see, there are essentially no distortions, so I don't notice any problems with image quality at this magnification. This construction crane is 500 meters away. This is at 50x magnification. Here you really need to focus well on the object for the image to be clear. And, as you may notice, various aberrations are starting to appear at the edges, spherical and chromatic, but I wouldn't say that it significantly affects the image quality. I can live with it. The image is fine for me.
Well, the next magnification is 75. Of course, the quality will be significantly worse than at 25x magnification, but look at the 75x magnification in SVB on and in cheap telescopes, and you will see the image quality there compared to here. Here, you need to quickly refocus. The distance is approximately 30 meters. It is very good that this telescope has a more precise refocusing, allowing you to achieve a very, very clear image of the object in the center. The phone amplifies the distortion. The image does not bend that much, but the distortion is still noticeable and present. You see, the arrow of the construction crane is in the center with a normal image, but a bit at the edges. Well, there is some normal chromaticity. You can see it yourself, but this is 75x magnification, and when you have such a high magnification, you essentially need to see a perfectly clear image in the center. In summary, I believe that the telescope is worth its money. The image quality is quite good. The only downside is that the prism was attached somewhat unreliably. So try not to throw the telescope. Thank you all for watching the video, and see you next time.